Good afternoon. I am Susan Weiss, Enterprise Editor at Kaiser Health News, and I just want to welcome you all and say how pleased I am that you're able to be here to join in our conversation about overtreatment. And it's a topic that our senior correspondent, Liz Szabo, has written extensively about, and we feel it's a really important issue for older Americans as well as younger Americans. And I would just like to introduce Program Director of the John A. Hartford Foundation, Ronnie Snyder, who is one of our funders and makes events like this happen, and she'll say a few remarks. Thank you.
Hi, I'll be brief. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Susan. And thank you to Kaiser Health News as well, because these events are really very interesting, as today promises to be, and important as well. We're really proud to support today's event and your full reporting desk that covers aging and health issues. So I am Ronnie Snyder. I have the great privilege of being the program director at the John A. Hartford Foundation. We are a nonpartisan national philanthropy that is based in in New York City, but operates nationally. We were established in 1929 by the family owners of the A&P grocery chain, and our mission is to improve the care of older adults. The John A. Hartford Foundation works in three different program areas. First, creating age-friendly health systems. Second, supporting family caregivers. And third, improving serious illness and end-of-life care. Across all three of those different areas, today's topic of overtreatment is really important and extremely relevant. So, for example, a core principle to us is our work to create age-friendly health systems really focuses on matching care with what matters to older adults. When healthcare providers know and are able to then act on our health outcome goals and our preferences, it should lead to reductions in unnecessary care, unnecessary tests, unnecessary procedures, and to better outcomes for all of us as well as our family caregivers. This is particularly critical for the people who are facing serious illness or end-of-life decision-making, as reported recently by Liz Szabo in her excellent Treatment Overkill series. So before I turn it over to Liz, I would like to invite you to learn more about one initiative that the Foundation is working on right now to bring what matters to older adults in more hospitals and health systems across the country. So our age-friendly health systems work is a joint initiative with the Institute for Healthcare Improvement in partnership with the American Hospital Association and the Catholic Health Association of the United States. So if you're interested in learning more about that, you can receive updates on the work and the project at AFHS, for age-friendly health systems, at IHI.org. So I want to thank you to Kaiser Health News today. I really want to thank the panelists, because we're very excited to hear this conversation, and to everyone in the audience for being here and also for continuing the conversation into the future.
Thank you, Ronnie. And I would also just like to welcome our audience on Facebook Live. We have our real audience and also our digital audience. And to get the conversation started, Liz Szabo. We'll introduce our esteemed panel.
Got to put the microphone way down for Szabo. Well, I just wanted to thank everyone for being here, both, as Susan said, our audience in the room to come out on this rainy, humid day, and also our audience out there on Facebook. So thanks to all of you for coming out to hear about overtreatment. Now, as Ronnie and Susan mentioned, I've been writing about overtreatment in a series called Treatment Overkill for over a year. But for a lot of people, this word overtreatment is kind of a new, unfamiliar word. So what really is overtreatment? Well, I think about overtreatment happening when there are unnecessary tests and therapies that don't really help and might actually harm people. Now, how common is it? There was a survey from Johns Hopkins just last year that asked doctors to estimate the rate of overtreatment, and they estimated it accounts for 21% of our medical care. And that's just an average and an estimate. But if you think about 1 out of 5 pills, 1 out of 5 tests, that seems pretty massive. And some people might say, well, why is that so wrong? What's wrong with doing an extra test? Isn't it better to be safe than sorry? Well, the cost of overtreatment has been estimated at $210 billion a year. And that's our money. And if we don't do something about overtreatment, that'll be our children's money, our grandchildren's money. So it's really a very expensive type of waste. And I'm hoping that some of the questions we'll address today are, what causes overtreatment? Where did this problem come from? How does it harm us? And most importantly, what can we do about it? And luckily, we're not alone in this question. We've got 5 of the smartest people in the country that I have brought here for you, all in one room. So it's my great, great honor to introduce Dr. Louise Davies. She is a professor of otolaryngology and head and neck surgery at the Dartmouth Institute for Clinical Outcomes. Health policy. I'm sorry, I brought the wrong. Thank you so much. And we also have Dr. Saurabh Jha. He's an associate professor of radiology at the University of Pennsylvania. We have Dr. Barry Kramer. He's director of the Division of Cancer Prevention at the National Cancer Institute. We have Dr. Jackie Cruiser, who is a pulmonologist and a critical care physician at Northwestern University Feinberg School of Medicine. And we have Dr. Renit Mishori, and she's a professor of family medicine at the Georgetown University School of Medicine. So you really couldn't do much better than this today. Let's kick things off by getting right into it with Dr. Mishori. Now, you and I have talked about the problem of over-medication, particularly in the elderly. What do we mean when we say over-medication for older people?
Be able to relate to a scenario of a patient coming to see me in my office with a little bag. Sometimes it's a plastic bag, sometimes it's a paper bag. And I ask them, so what are you on? Let's review your medications. And they open it, and I, on my table in my exam room, there are about 20, 30, sometimes even more bottles of medications. And oftentimes, the medications, the patients have no idea why they're taking them. Sometimes the medications have been prescribed years ago and just nobody cared to stop them. Sometimes the medications are to treat side effects from other medications. So it's a very, very common issue for primary care physicians, and it's a really huge challenge because in medical education, we are taught how to prescribe medications, but really nobody teaches us how to de-prescribe medications. And it's an art, not so much a science anymore, or not yet a science, because there are not a lot of studies that actually talk about how to do it effectively and safely. But it's an issue that has caused side effects, death, unnecessary falls. This is very, very common in the elderly population, but not only. Anyone who has a chronic disease may be subject to the issue of over-medication and polypharmacy.
Wow. So when I was writing about this, someone on Twitter said, well, what's the big deal if you're taking extra medications? What's the big deal about being a little dizzy or having a fall? Isn't it better to prevent that heart attack? Can you talk a little bit about those consequences and the real serious health effects?
Yeah. So every medication that you take, regardless of what it is, it could be over-the-counter, it could be prescribed by a doctor, has potential side effects. And people need to remember that. And sometimes what happens is you sort of balance the benefits versus the harms. So you want to take a medication that will treat something, given that you know that you will have some side effects. But sometimes the side effects themselves are debilitating. And you have, then somebody will prescribe something to you for dizziness, for example, not realizing that the dizziness is really a reaction to another medication that you're on. And there's sort of a domino effect. And dizziness can cause falls. So maybe somebody who is an elderly person falls, breaks their hip, and then they die. And the initial reason why they were dizzy was because of a medication that they didn't need to be on in the first place. So these are not benign issues. Medication side effects are not benign. Polypharmacy is not benign, and we need to really think about how we prevent these side effects and terrible mortality and morbidity and mortality. People die from over-medication.
I think really good points. Now, you mentioned one of the most serious things that can happen is a fall and a hip fracture. Someone could end up hospitalized. I know one of the first things that happens when people go to the hospital is they often will get an x-ray or maybe a CAT scan. Dr. Jha, I know some of these imaging studies are really important and life-saving, but do doctors ever overdo it with medical imaging? Are they all necessary?
Yeah, it's a great question. So being a radiologist, one of the things that I have to do is manage uncertainty of physicians, uncertainty of patients, and sometimes I actually compound the issue, make them more uncertain than they were before they started. And one particular instance that I recall, when I became an attending, it was like my first or second year, a lady came in with suspected pulmonary embolism. She had difficulty in breathing. She had a CAT scan to rule out pulmonary embolism. There was no pulmonary embolism, so
What exactly is a pulmonary embolism?
That's when there's a clot in the lungs. It can be quite dangerous if it's a big clot, but there are very small clots as well that can get overdiagnosed and overtreated. And so I looked at the scan and I said no pulmonary embolism, but then I did something else which led to a cascade of investigations. I measured the main pulmonary artery size, and it was 3.3 centimeters, and there is a threshold, 3.1 centimeters, above which one should suspect pulmonary hypertension. So I said possible pulmonary hypertension, which is an entity that has its own morbidity. And I helpfully added the limitations of the study, thereby suggesting that maybe more studies would be indicated. Anyway, I don't meet patients, I don't see them, so I forgot about this case until a cardiologist patted me on the back and said, do you realize that this lady whose CT scan you read, you've got her through a cascade of investigations. And then she also had a right heart catheter, which is like the gold standard for pulmonary hypertension, which she, of course, didn't have. And in a sense, I was actually following the rules, because it was disseminated in our education, this number, 3.1 centimeter. But what wasn't disseminated, what I began to realize later on, was that the chances of actually picking somebody up with pulmonary hypertension, minding their own business, using that number, is overwhelmed by the chances of actually causing a false positive and putting somebody through a train of investigations. So since then, I've begun to be more judicious with measuring, more judicious with what I say, realizing that anything that's printed in the report can just, you know, can be like a Greek tragedy, very difficult to reverse afterwards. So yes, these tests are often necessary. I wouldn't necessarily call them waste, but we're deluged with this information. We've got too much information. I think we're still struggling how to manage the information that we have.
Yeah, it seems to me like when we talk about overdiagnosis, that tests are in some ways can be thought of as the gateway to overdiagnosis. Is that sort of where it all begins, is when you do a test?
Absolutely. And the other organ that's unfortunately badgered quite a bit is the thyroid, because the thyroid unfortunately comes in the field of view when we do a CAT scan of the chest. And I've tried a lot of times just avoiding the thyroid, but you just can't. And once you see the thyroid, there is, you know, there's potential for there being a nodule. And once there's a potential for there being a nodule, the patient has a thyroid ultrasound, a biopsy, which shows papillary carcinoma of the thyroid, which is an entity that's hugely overdiagnosed and overtreated based on very reliable population-based studies from South Korea. So it's a hard problem. I mean, really, the only two ways out of it is just not to comment on it or to have very nuanced shared decision-making.
Yeah, these are all really, really tricky questions. And while we're still thinking about hospital care, I know most people go to the hospital to get care when they're injured or when they're sick. But so much of the care that we receive these days is aimed at preventing illness, or at least catching it in an earlier, more treatable, more curable stage. And that can lead to cancer screenings. Dr. Kramer, you've done a lot of research on cancer screening. You know, people will get up and say, oh, cancer screening saved my life. And in talking to you, I know you say that's not necessarily the case. Cancer screenings can also be problematic. Can you explain why?
Yeah, first let me start with a disclaimer. I'm certainly not one of the smartest people in the country. I'm certainly not even one of the smartest people in the room. But I think I'm the smartest person sitting in this chair right now. And so take what I'm about to say with a grain of salt. As you pointed out, there are a lot of misconceptions surrounding screening. It's a lot more counterintuitive than people seem to think, and certainly more counterintuitive than the one-line sound bites that you see on posters and hear from television ads all the time. It's fair to say that every screening test has associated harms or triggers associated harms. Some screening tests, but not all, will incur a benefit, and we always have to sort out the balance of benefits and harms before we start making blanket recommendations, in my opinion. As a matter of fact, it's an ethical issue. It's a different set of ethics that you apply to a patient who is suffering from cancer. They don't necessarily want you to wait for the very, very strongest evidence. They want their suffering relieved. That's not true for screening, which is aimed at asymptomatic people. There, I believe there should be an even higher bar for the strength of evidence. So what are the harms of screening that are routinely incurred? We've learned over the last decades that cancer is not a monolithic entity. We tend to carry around our heads, unfortunately, that it's a death sentence. And if you don't do something, then you will die, and we assume that it's always better to pick up cancer earlier than later. And that's not always the case. You have to weigh benefits versus harms. Cancer, virtually every cancer, has a very broad spectrum of activity. From very indolent, not completely non-progressive, or even some will spontaneously regress, all the way up to the cancers that all of us fear so much, those that move so quickly. And it turns out, sadly, most screening tests are not very good at picking up at the fastest moving cancers. And so the spectrum of behavior in cancer has been likened to birds and bears and turtles. The birds escape far too soon to do anything about it. And no matter how sensitive the screening test is, it misses the ones that are destined to kill the patient. The next order of magnitude or behavior is the bear, and those are the ones that would escape if given enough time, but hopefully a screening test will allow you to detect them and do something about it before they escape. The third category are the turtles. The ones you don't have to worry about. They move so slowly, you don't need a screening test. And as I alluded to the analogy before, in some cases, we're even dealing with snails, those that are pretty much immobile. Clearly, it does no good to pick up the snails or the turtles. It doesn't do any good to simply pick up birds that have already escaped and metastasized before the test picks up the disease. It's the bears that we are hoping to pick up by our screening tests. And there, we always can be confident that there are turtles and snails and almost always birds. What we are looking for in our studies is to find out if there are bears and if we can do something about them before they escape. If you pick up a tumor that's overdiagnosed and never destined to harm the patient, it is pure harm. There is no benefit that I can think of in curing a patient of cancer that never needed to be cured in the first place, or taking a healthy person and converting them into a cancer patient. Labeling hurts. And so those, in a nutshell, are some of the harms that are very difficult to detect without large, carefully performed studies, usually randomized.
I guess the trouble is there are occasionally times when you'll know that someone was harmed by a cancer treatment, but it can be very hard in the case of an individual to know, okay, let's see, you've had your prostate out, you're now going to suffer from erectile dysfunction and incontinence for the remainder of your days, and was that surgery really worth it, or did we put you through a lot of needless suffering for nothing? I guess on an individual level, there's no real way to know right now.
Yeah, so that's an important area of research, Liz, and it's extremely important. First, I think we all accept that cancer is one of the most fearsome diseases in our society, perhaps the most fearsome. And so a lot of behavior is driven by the fear rather than strong evidence. A peculiar thing about overdiagnosis is that although it can be detected often at the population level, when you see many, many more diagnoses of cancer associated with screening, but no change in risk of actually dying, at the individual level, it is much more difficult to see. As a matter of fact, at the clinical and individual level, there are almost no negative feedback loops. The doctor feels that he's done everything possible when he offers a test. The patient feels that they have done everything possible. If it was overdiagnosed and they were cured when they didn't need to be cured in the first place, they of course don't recognize that, and you often get people who will go public and become strong advocates and say that they are living proof that screening works, and of course they couldn't know that at the individual level. So you've brought up one of the key areas of research at the National Cancer Institute, and in particular my division, and that is trying to use newly developed molecular tools to identify overdiagnosis versus progressive disease at the individual tumor and patient level, so that ultimately we hope to be able to tell the patient, your screen-detected cancer is virtually certainly overdiagnosed, and it's there is no benefit to you personally to having it treated at this point. We ought to hold our fire and follow you and not do anything unless it starts to progress. For some diseases we're getting there. We look at the histology of the tumor. We look at crude markers, but we have a long way to go to get down to the molecular fingerprint pattern that would be of most use to physicians, clinicians, and their patients.
Now, one of the real effects of screening is that it often leads to surgery. Dr. Davies, as a surgeon, I was hoping you can talk a little bit about when surgery can become a form of overtreatment.
Yeah, I think it's often hard for us to understand that sometimes surgery is an overtreatment, because it always feels like, well, if the surgeon thinks it's a good idea, it must be a good idea. But I think there's actually some tricks to understand the range of ways that surgery can be overtreatment. I'll just maybe start with one. And I think one is to understand when you're managing a person who actually has competing illnesses, we call it, meaning they actually have other problems that might make it not a good idea to do either this particular procedure at this point in time, or maybe even to do the surgery at all. An example from my practice is we recently had a gentleman come in who had a thyroid cancer, and actually he has a fairly large thyroid cancer. Many thyroid cancers we see these days probably would be better off not treated with surgery, initially at least. But he had a cancer that most people would say probably needs to come out. But he was also on oxygen, and he had fairly bad vascular disease. And actually, he was probably more likely to die from his heart and vascular problems than he was of his thyroid cancer. And so we needed to have a discussion about that. So that's one example.
Wow. Yeah, I did know someone who had, her husband had heart disease, and he'd so bad that he'd had stents. And when he was diagnosed with prostate cancer, they elected to give him something called brachytherapy, where they put little radioactive seeds around the prostate. And the radiation, unfortunately, caused a lot of tissue death, and he developed this terrible infection and gangrene, they were almost going to amputate his leg, and he became he developed sepsis and died. And it was devastating for her to lose her husband. She was still relatively young. She quit her job and moved away. Yeah. And I think that's one case where he did not die from the prostate cancer. He died from the treatment, and we can say that.
And I think that's when you can even, it's when a surgery that was indicated, but actually in retrospect, becomes over-treatment when you see the side effects that happen afterwards, where, oh, actually, that seemed like the right thing to do, but now here we are in the intensive care unit, and how did we actually get here, and what are we going to do now? And that's when surgery that actually seemed indicated can become over-treatment.
And I'm glad you mentioned the ICU, because Dr. Kruiser is a specialist in ICU medicine. And you and I had talked about how there can be a sort of snowball effect in medicine, and one intervention can lead seamlessly to another, it can be hard to sort of stop doing something. Can you talk a little bit about that, and how does that train get started?
Yeah, and I think this is an important theme that's come up from a couple of our panelists today, that it feels like over-treatment is not one particular treatment, but it's a series or a train or a phenomenon that gets started by one seemingly innocuous test, but it leads to further treatments and further tests. So our research group likes to call this phenomenon clinical momentum. And when we see this for acutely ill patients who are so sick they need to be in the hospital, sort of similarly, it can be counterintuitive to think of over-treatment for patients who are very sick or acutely ill. And so I just want to highlight a couple of features of the inpatient acute hospital system that may potentially lead to over-treatment. So one thing that's very important to understand is that when you come into the hospital, to the emergency room, you get admitted to an inpatient floor, even have to come to the intensive care unit where I work, your healthcare team, the doctors, the nurses, everyone taking care of you, is laser focused on the acute problems that have brought you there. The abnormalities that they've detected on your blood tests or on your radiology studies. And most importantly, they want to act quickly to fix them. So we see acute problems as individual, isolated issues, and we've been trained to act quickly to rectify those issues, to support them, to change them, to fix them. And a second key point is that this hospital system, the environment, is designed to fix things rapidly. We can get lab tests back in minutes, we can rush someone off to the operating room within an hour, we can provide bedside emergency procedures, for example, in the ICU or I practice, within minutes. We have all of the supplies necessary, either in every patient room or right outside the door, to provide an emergency procedure, a variety of different emergency procedures right at the bedside. So this environment and this system where we're very focused on fixing individual problems and fixing them quickly because patients are very sick, works for a lot of patients. The vast majority of people coming into the hospital, their goal is to survive, to cure the acute illness, and to get better. But what we worry about and what our research group is really thinking about is, what about the patients who may have different goals? And so, for example, if some patients have a goal to avoid invasive procedures or burdensome treatments, or maybe their most important goal is to spend as much time as possible communicating with their family, being at home, eating what they want to eat, or maybe even feeling well enough to go to a family wedding in a couple of weeks. All of these different cascading interventions might not help us accomplish those goals for that patient. So what we really want to focus on, and in our work, what we want to focus on is ways we can help change the system. So just like we have all of the emergency treatments readily available at the bedside for patients who are very sick, one of the things that it's even harder to find in an ICU or on a hospital ward is enough chairs for everybody to sit down with a patient in their room, with their family, their doctors, and talk about what's most important to them. And so we really want to think about ways we can start helping change the healthcare system that focuses on individual patients' goals and avoiding overtreatment in that sense.
I love the idea of chairs as an important medical tool so that you can really discuss things. You know, so much of this idea of overtreatment is sort of abstract. Can you break it down with maybe an example or a narrative? Can you pick someone who would come in with a typical condition and how that might snowball out of control?
Yeah, so I can tell you the story of a patient I took care of a few years ago, and it may seem a little bit meandering, but I think I want to sort of give you all of the details to show you how these interventions can snowball. So for this patient, he had progressive cancer, and he was on chemotherapy. It seemed to be working, that the cancer hadn't spread. But because his immune system was low from the chemotherapy, he unfortunately developed a pneumonia. And the pneumonia is what brought him to the hospital the first time. He was treated with antibiotics and oxygen in the hospital. And as he was recovering, because he had been in bed for some time, they found a blood clot in his lung. And so he was treated with blood thinners. And he was starting to get stronger. And what he really wanted was to go home. But the physical therapist came, evaluated him in the hospital, and said, "What I really think is you should go to acute inpatient rehab. There you could get stronger." And his doctors and his oncologist told him that if he got stronger faster, they could restart the chemotherapy. And that is what he had been doing before this pneumonia set him back in the first place. So he went to the acute inpatient rehabilitation center. And unfortunately, while he was there, he developed a very significant bleeding complication from the blood thinner into his lung. And so he came back to the hospital again. And this time, he was so sick that he had to come to the intensive care unit. And he had to have a breathing tube, and he was supported with a breathing machine, a ventilator. He was in shock and needed a variety of different interventions to support him and give him blood transfusions. And as he started to feel a little bit better, we realized he was still dependent on this breathing machine. And he was writing to us and to his wife, who was at the bedside. And again, what he said is, "All I really want is to be at home." And unfortunately, at that point in his care, we had gotten to the point where it probably was impossible to ever achieve that goal.
That's incredibly sad. And it sounds like the source of all these problems was the blood thinner, because they were worried about the pulmonary embolism. Would the lesson be ignore the pulmonary embolism? What's the lesson?
I think, and maybe this is sort of another theme that came up, but it's really only possible in hindsight, I think, for this patient to say what was overtreatment and what the problem was. Because it is true that blood clots can cause problems, and blood thinners are the appropriate treatment. And so this is why this problem of overtreatment, and even calling it overtreatment, can be so complicated. Because when something transitions from treatment to overtreatment is often almost impossible to tell.
Well, I'm wondering, you know, how, since we have been talking about this domino effect and a snowball effect, and how it can sometimes seem like you're on this speeding train of interventions, is there a way to avoid getting on that train? How do we avoid putting ourselves in this really high-risk position? Does anyone just open for the
floor? Dr. Ritter, I was just going to say, you know, I agree with you. It's often true that, like, we only recognize in retrospect, like, oh, there's this sinking feeling that I think everybody gets of, how did we get here? And it feels like having these conversations ahead of time can be a really important way to set the stage for what might happen next. And I think you've actually done some work in this area, so I'll let you talk about it, but it feels like those conversations that come ahead of time are actually one of the keys.
Yeah, I think so. And maybe the one way that that we've started to think about how to predict the future. So one thing that as physicians I think we all feel is that there's an incredible amount of uncertainty around these decisions. And we don't know how to tell you if you're going to be the person, in most cases we don't know how to tell you if you're going to be the person that has a bleeding complication from the blood thinner or the person who has a major problem from the blood clot that we're trying to treat in the first place. So what we've tried to focus on is different ways that we can talk about the range of potential outcomes. So instead of trying to define what exactly is going to happen for you, helping patients and their families and caregivers acknowledge the uncertainty about the fact that we don't often know, but then also provide you a range to say, in the best case scenario, this is what I think could happen. And in the worst case scenario, if things don't go as planned, this is what we think might happen. And then with that range and that type of information, patients and families can start to have the conversation ahead of time about what treatments may be acceptable and tolerable to them and what may be unacceptable.
I think in the context of taking it back even a few steps, when you first get the diagnosis in my setting, in the primary care setting, trying to figure out what the patient's values are for their care, even before you end up in the ICU. Once you end up in the ICU, it's very, very difficult to say, well, I don't want this to happen. Yeah. And there's usually no time, there's acuity. But if you take a little breather, either maybe you're in the ICU or maybe even years later with your primary care doctor who may have known you for 25 years and knows your values, what you want to get out of your treatment, what you get out of life, how long you want to live, what the quality of life is that you're aspiring to have. That's a conversation that needs to happen maybe before you come up with a serious diagnosis, maybe as you are faced with a serious diagnosis, whether it's cancer or other chronic diseases. There is time to kind of put the brakes before you find yourself in the ICU really with very little opportunity to kind of really ponder and reflect on these issues.
I think it's this idea of bringing up the idea that, you know what, actually we are all going to die at some point, right. It turns out. And so maybe actually it's better if we sort of accept, okay, what is the range of experiences that I want to have and how do I want things to unfold for me in the time that I have available, whether it's 40 years or 40 days, right?
So the scenario you describe in the ICU with pulmonary embolism, there's another situation where you have on the CAT scan detection of subsegmental pulmonary embolism, which is the smallest of smallest arteries, a clot in that, which is very much responsible for overdiagnosis. And I think specialist societies do have a role here to play, because at first you have to accept that unless you have perfect information, unless you know for sure who's going to be overtreated, who's going to be undertreated, it's going to be a trade-off, both at a population level and at an individual level, between the decision to overtreat and the decision to undertreat. But you have to also identify those areas where the trade-off between over and under is going to be the highest. And specialist societies can have a role here by saying that when it comes to very, very small clots, either put a bracket of uncertainty, qualitatively or quantitatively, or try not to make a song and dance about it. And even better, ignore them.
So perhaps my own personal story or family story can help as a lesson to how to avoid overtreatment. This is not overdiagnosis, but overtreatment. My mother had reached her 80s, and she felt like she had been healthy all of her life, never even went to see physicians. Her biggest disappointment during that phase of her life was that my father had passed away, and they didn't quite make it to their 50th anniversary, and she was extremely disappointed. And she, by then, she was also developing some dementia. Well before she suffered dementia, years before, she and my father would impress on me that neither wanted heroic measures ever when the time came. And as a matter of fact, they kept checking to make sure we had the paperwork in our safe so that we could show it to a physician who might overtreat them. I went to my mother's house to pick her up for lunch. She'd been looking forward to it for days. She passed out in the lobby of her apartment building, and we took her to the emergency room, whereupon they found out she was anemic, but the first thing I almost always do is a CT scan, and they pulled me out of the room to say, we have some very bad news. Your mother has almost certainly a kidney cancer. Because on the CT scan, they saw a huge tumor, which was undoubtedly a cancer. And they said, we have to admit her into the hospital to transfuse her, and we'll schedule a biopsy. And I said, I want to think about that biopsy. My mother always said, and there was no effective therapy for kidney cancers of that size at that time. And so she was admitted to the hospital. She hated it. She had to be there for the transfusion. She kept calling me over and whispering. And she pulled me over and she said, Barry, I hate this place. I said, I know, Mom, it won't be long. And she said, no, you're not hearing. I hate this place. I want to go home. And so the physician tried to impress on us that we wouldn't know the diagnosis 100% sure without that biopsy. I did not want my mother to undergo it. She wouldn't have understood why, but she had told me some many times before she didn't want any heroism, and this would have been such a case. And so I had to call my son to drive over to sit with her at her bedside the whole night, and the next morning we brought her home. Over the next 4 months, she had a great 4 months because people were coming over to visit her, and she was seeing people she had never seen, hadn't seen in years, going through photograph books, calling me at work, saying, you know, Barry, it's a miracle. All my friends have passed away. I've been so healthy all my life, and I'm still so healthy. And so it was gratifying to me that she basically died without knowing ever that she had cancer and that she had such a good time in those last 4 months.
Oh, wow.
And so that's a lesson to everyone to make sure that whoever it is that can make decisions for you knows years before you ever get sick what you want done if, because we live in a society where you can suddenly fall into this inescapable vortex from which there is no escape.
And I guess one of the issues for the people at the hospital when they said, well, our standard is to admit her and we'll do the biopsy. I forget how you said your mom was in her 80s. And I guess maybe they might say it's ageist to have one way of responding for a 25-year-old and one way of responding for an 85-year-old. But I've heard some people say that, you know, sometimes we will treat the same condition in people the same regardless of their age. And, you know, maybe at a certain point we need to think, you know, what are we really preventing, or, you know, do we need to take their age into consideration?
Not just age, but also, so if I have a patient who is, both of them are perfectly healthy, one is an athlete with knee pain, and one is a, you know, very healthy but a sedentary lifestyle, maybe even somewhat active. Does that person need the knee surgery? I would argue that it's the same, you know, they're both healthy, maybe it's the same condition, but their values are different. The athlete wants to go back, and that's their career, that's their life, that's what they get most satisfaction from. And the other person may not need their knee in the same way that the athlete needs the knee. So it's not just about age, but it's what are your values? If you're a pianist, you need your hands more than somebody who doesn't work with their hands so much. So again, that would be the threshold for me as a family physician to say, well, I think really you should consider having surgery much more because you're depending on that organ. And you know, maybe if you can live with a little bit of pain, a little bit of discomfort, it's not going to matter to your life as much. But so, again, we're talking about guidelines. We're talking about general recommendations. You know, the Choosing Wisely campaign is a phenomenal way to kind of think about the care that you should or should not get. But in the end, it's about the patient, their values, maybe their profession, maybe what they want to achieve on a day-to-day basis, which has to make us as a team with their family members come to some sort of a joint decision about intervention versus no intervention.
And I'll point out that especially with respect to cancer screening, I only covered the underlying biology as a big driver of overdiagnosis. But remaining life expectancy is often equally important. Remember, cancer is by and large, not always, but by and large, a disease of aging. And so when you're at increased risk of dying of cancer, you're at increased risk of dying of a whole host of other diseases. And even if the cancer is not one of the snails or turtles, it is possible that it is going to grow slowly enough that you don't have enough remaining years to benefit. And in the area of cancer screening, all too frequently, the benefits, even if they're there, are delayed by many years, but the harms are front-loaded, starting with the day you get the diagnosis. But then we can fit in an awful lot of therapy in a very short period of time, very early on for a cancer patient. And it is no secret that many of the therapies that we employ to treat cancer can be very, very toxic.
You're talking about ageism. For one of the things that CMS has done, it's a good thing, is that for lung cancer screening with CT, one of the criterion for screening, one is shared decision making, explaining the harms of screening, but the other one is actually an understanding of the life expectancy of the patient, of the person. I can't remember offhand the number, whether it's 10 years or 5 years, perhaps it's 10 years, but if you believe that it's 10 years, then that person is no longer suitable for screening. So it's out there explicitly. It's a matter of actually having that discussion in a professional and diplomatic manner. I don't think it helps telling people that we're not going to screen you because you could die in, let me say, 7 years' time.
I wonder if I could go back to something that Dr. Mashouri was saying. It changes the topic a little bit, but it's this idea that, at least in surgery, we often think about, this is going to cure your problem. But actually, when it comes to elective surgery, so I'm not even talking about people who are older, but at all walks of life and all their ages, there's this problem, and a way to avoid overtreatment is to understand the natural history of the disease that you're experiencing, because our tendency in surgery and in much of medicine is to intervene at the period of peak symptoms. And in fact, the natural history of many illnesses is that they wax and wane in severity. And so we do surgery, we think somebody got better from it, but in fact, actually, they got better because time passed. And so when you have that knee patient in front of you in the office, there's also this sense of, okay, have we actually exhausted all of our medical options? And also, what is likely to happen in the future with this illness? Is it going to continue to escalate? Or actually, do we have some time to think and to work through it a little bit?
Now, that's a good point about the time. I think one of the, there's this program called Choosing Wisely. It's a set of advice by doctors for doctors to try to help doctors choose when to use.
There's a very good patient version of it. And I think actually, unfortunately, most doctors in different specialties, Choosing Wisely was created for multiple specialties, don't know about it, that it exists. And these are evidence-based recommendations of what you should and you should not do. But there's a patient version, and I always try to give my patients who come for overtreatment, one of the classic things is a patient who comes in for pre-op evaluation before cataract surgery, which is completely uncalled for and unnecessary. I say, well, this is, the American Academy of Ophthalmology recommends against doing that, and here's your information. And I often send that same sheet of paper to the ophthalmologist who wanted to do this. And I said, well, your own professional association recommends against it. So, we need to have physicians and patients be aware of the evidence. And but everybody here was saying, and ground that in shared decision making and looking at the patient as an individual.
And understand as part of a system, right? So not to like totally diss on the ophthalmologist, right? We can also diss on the anesthesiologist and our whole preoperative workup culture, where we all feel that we need to have all this information when actually it may or may not impact decision making later on, right?
Yeah. And I think similarly with the appropriateness, tell me if I'm wrong, but what is called the American Academy of Radiology has the appropriateness criteria of what's appropriate in terms of.
Yeah, so there is an appropriateness criteria which tells you which test to get if you suspect a certain diagnosis, and that's very good. What it doesn't tell you is when you should suspect that diagnosis.
But it's useful for me as a family physician, and somebody comes in with low back pain, and I can come up with a certain plan for them, but then I can check the appropriateness criteria and say, well, maybe you don't need that x-ray of your lower back just yet, and we can wait. This is something that we can try to use more conservative treatment for before we send you off, and who knows what the domino effect of that will be.
That's a good point. Well, I really appreciate, Dr. Kramer, you're telling that personal family story. And as we were getting ready for this conference and having lunch, we were exchanging personal stories. And I know I have several stories in my family about overtreatment. And I'm wondering if anyone in the audience has questions or has had an experience with overtreatment, either in their own life or a relative that you'd like to share or ask a question about. Oh, I think, do we have a microphone that we can pass to you?
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Dr. Srinivasan. I'm a senior fellow at the National Center for Health Research. I don't know how relevant this question is, but I have a bottle of vitamins on my table. And I stare at it every morning, along with my thyroid medication. I'm like, should I take it? Some days I forget, and I feel really bad about it. And I'm like, oh, I don't really care about my health. And so I'm wondering, you know, even when I asked my family physician, who treats me for my thyroid, and I said, I went to CVS, and I didn't know which one to pick, and this one looked somewhat expensive and looked like a good brand with a good logo, so I picked it up. Is it okay? It's like, it's fine. So I still don't know if it's fine. I have no idea. And so I want to know, to what extent do you think that vitamins and minerals and probiotics are a part of the whole overtreatment that we're talking about? And it's not, some physicians like would say no, but there are going to be people that go to these and that are not regulated. So I guess it's sort of like selfish advice that I also want is that, is it necessary? Do I need to take it?
Do you want to talk about it?
That's a great question.
That's a good question.
Really good question.
I can give you at least some answers with respect to cancer, because often people are taking vitamins because they think it protects them from cancer. I had an old a boss years ago who used to say that Americans have the most nutritious urine in the world. Because so much of it just comes straight through your system. We have finely tuned regulatory mechanisms in our body to keep us in range. And most people, certainly middle class and above, almost can't avoid an adequate diet. But most people take vitamins for, quote, insurance, just because they've been told through messaging that no one has an adequate diet, so you better take vitamins. With respect to cancer, and first of all, the whole industry for vitamins is sort of the Wild West, because as you pointed out, it is not regulated as though they are drugs, and they don't even have to have data to show that it protects against disease. There are cases where vitamins have been shown to protect against disease. Pregnancy, there are cases, and I don't want to speak against them. But with respect to cancer, we've had the devil of a time figuring out which of any vitamins or multivitamins actually protect against cancer. That's not to say we don't conduct a lot of research to see if they do, but there have been a lot of disappointments based on assumptions. A painful lesson that I have learned in my career is that it is not enough to depend on a tight molecular story. Many of our grants are to look at molecular pathways, and they say this is how this particular micronutrient would protect against cancer. And I always ask, I'm not interested in how it would protect against cancer. I'm interested in, does it protect against cancer? And I'd like to start with that as a key question. And then at the other end, epidemiology. People who take vitamins tend to be the healthiest people in our society. This is self-selection bias. They are health conscious. They are, just like all of us, making a heroic effort to live forever. And so they are scanning the internet every 15 minutes to see if there's another secret that will help them live forever. And they happen to take vitamins and have a better diet anyway, and they exercise, and they don't smoke. They maintain normal body weight, and on and on and on. So very frequently, you can be terribly misled by the confounding factors that travel with taking a vitamin. And so the long and short of it with respect to cancer in the average population, I'm not talking about rural populations in China that really are vitamin depleted. I'm talking about the United States. By and large, we have had a great deal of difficulty in randomized trials showing any benefit. Sometimes we see harms. Studies have shown, randomized trials compared to placebo, that beta carotene is not good for smokers. It increases their risk of getting lung cancer and increases their risk of dying of lung cancer. There are other vitamins that seem to predispose to prostate cancer in randomized trials, diabetes. And so my advice is to look at the PDQ. This is another way to avoid overtreatment. The National Cancer Institute has an online database. I chair that editorial board, Screening and Prevention. It's at cancer.gov. And we make no recommendations for or against. We simply summarize what is known, the good, the bad, and the unknown, for a whole range of interventions that have been touted to protect or not with cancer or harm. And then you can read what is known about the magnitude of benefits and harms.
But if I may just add very briefly, this is true for cancer, cardiovascular disease, the same. There are not a lot of studies that show that there's any benefit. But beside the point, to make a bigger point is, you are only taking one other medication and you can afford it, and maybe you don't have other health conditions that may interact with whatever it is that's in those supplements that you want to take. But so for you, the harms, the benefit of benefit and harms would be different than somebody who's already on several other medications, has some health conditions that may be affected by extra vitamin E, extra vitamin D, extra calcium. Those can all be harmful to some extent depending on dosing and depending on other medications and other health conditions. So again, to take it back is, A, is there any benefit? Possibly not, no benefit for either cancer or cardiovascular disease in taking vitamins. Number two, what are your harms specifically to you? Are there harms because of what other medications you're taking, because of other conditions that you're suffering from? And that's how you make that decision. So I don't like your family physician saying, yeah, sure, go ahead. Probably in their mind, it's like, oh, it's probably not so harmful for a young, healthy woman like you. But that shouldn't be the knee-jerk reaction. It should be looking at you as a complex organism and then making that call.
I have to confess, I take fish oil daily. And that's not for myself, it's because my wife makes me. So by being overtreated, yes, what are the harms? There are a lot of harms. I don't take it.
I'm John Rother. Thank you for coming. It's an excellent panel. But I want to push back a little bit because it seems to me that there are pretty large variations in utilization from one place to another, which indicates, or at least suggests, a pretty pervasive over utilization of certain procedures. And I wonder what you think accounts for that, and to what extent fee-for-service reimbursement encourages over-utilization, over-treatment.
And just for those who aren't familiar with fee-for-service, that's where you do something and you get paid by the service. Right?
Like, can I take that one as to start?
Sure.
So this is just a great point that you brought up. And I think, so there are tremendous variations in lots of procedures. You know, everything from C-sections to surgery for low back pain to how we treat thyroid cancer, all of these things. And yes, some of it is the fee-for-service model where you get paid, if you do more procedures, you get paid more because you get paid, it's like piecework essentially, right? But there's also something about the culture that we set up, and the local culture in each location in the country actually drives a lot of what we do. And people like to say, oh, the patients are demanding it. And yes, the patients are demanding it, but also it's how we as physicians think about what's necessary and how we create the culture of need, both by the relationships that we have amongst ourselves and with industry, and just sort of how things work in any particular location. So one simple example from thyroid cancer is actually, depending on what part of the country you go to, you'll be treated surgically by a general surgeon or an otolaryngologist. And that actually is just kind of depends on who in that community is the surgeon who serves that community. And that's just an example of how local practices, local cultures actually drive a lot of the variation. So it's fee for service, but it's also very complex. It's about relationships.
So I used to work in the NHS before I came to the States. And so there is definitely a difference. There's no doubt that the fee-for-service does something. I think it's more of an enabler. It's like a it's like a six-lane freeway. And it allows uncertainty to express itself. But really the driver, from what I see, is uncertainty. There's a level of uncertainty that people are becoming intolerant of. I think it's largely physicians, although there may be patients too, but largely physicians. And the mere presence of certain imaging modalities that you can get pretty much as by pressing a button means that you're even more intolerant of uncertainty. And that uncertainty is different for different people. Even amongst radiologists, how we manage findings, I'm very different from many of my colleagues. Some are more conservative than I am, and some are more liberal in recommending other tests than I am.
Maybe I can move a little bit into the research arena, because one of the most important things that Dartmouth did was generate these geographic maps of procedures around the country. And whenever you see a huge variation in medical intervention, you can almost assume that there isn't uniform agreement on the benefits versus harms or the overall utility and efficacy of the intervention. In the area of cancer, we complement that by looking, we have a national system to record cancers, the SEER database. So if you look at variation in interventions and map that against differences in risk of dying, you can get a pretty good indicator when overdiagnosis is at hand. And just as examples, years ago, there was a map that showed a dramatic difference between the Northwest and Northeast in radical prostatectomy. No difference whatsoever in risk of dying of prostate cancer. In both areas, prostate cancer mortality was dropping and at the very same rate, and so it was hard to attribute to screening. There are similar types of observations for example, mammography, which can vary by community to community dramatically, and you can map that against risk of dying of breast cancer, and on and on. So it's not just, for journalists, I think it's always a good idea to take a look at what's going, is there geographic variability, and does it account for any differences in mortality, and often the difference in practice doesn't match differences in mortality.
And I'd like to sort of comment, there's also known regional variation in the use of intensive care unit stay at the end of life, for example. And I think, you know, one thing, the first part of your question is, what do we think drives this variation or sort of these big differences? And I think one overarching point I think that's really important is that the drivers are often very latent. So it's not a physician sitting at the bedside, in my opinion, it's not a physician sitting at the bedside thinking, in this fee-for-service environment, I'm going to gain more financially from this procedure. I think it's much more latent. And maybe an example of what I mean by that is there's some really interesting health services research in the ICU realm, and even some of this comes from Canada, so outside of the United States, that merely having open and available ICU beds makes it more likely that a sick patient is going to be transferred to the ICU. So even some of these system features, how many beds are available, or how many surgeons are there, or is there a surgeon available on call 24 hours a day, that we don't often recognize in the moment of the actual decision that we're making, start to influence and I think play a big role in this regional variation.
And I think one other piece of variation is specialties. So as a family physician, I go by the American Academy of Family Physicians. So how we treat hypertension, for example, is different because we decided that we go by these, by the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force or other, whether we do pelvic exams is different than what other specialties. So there is a difference in the intensity of treatment, in the what we even offer, depending on different conditions. Prediabetes is, again, another classic example that You know, one specialty may treat it one way, and another specialty like mine would treat it a completely different way. So how each organization interprets the data and interprets the guidelines is, again, another cause for huge variation.
Wow, we've got lots of questions. That makes me really happy. Do we want to take any from Facebook?
We have a question from one of our Facebook viewers. My mom is in her 80s, very sharp and responsible for her own care. She has had various experiences with physicians who did not welcome her questions about whether she really needed certain medications or tests. They were rather dismissive. Do you have any advice for patients about how to start these conversations constructively?
Great question.
I'm happy to take it since it's something that I do every day. I think, first of all, we need to figure out what are we treating? What are the goals of treatment? What are the goals of a relief of a symptom or treatment of, sometimes we treat conditions that you don't feel that you have and you're asymptomatic. So what are the goals? Are you looking to have to be free of pain? Are you looking to go back to your previous level of activity? So again, it's part of the conversations of we mentioned before about the goals of care, the goals of your quality of life, what you're hoping to get out of day to day. I think, you know, this is up to the patient to some extent to come to the physicians and say, I have these questions. What is this medication? What is this condition that I'm having? What are the options of treatment? What are the pluses and minuses? What are the benefits and harms of this treatment? Let's have this conversation. And this kind of conversation should happen in every single exam room with every single physician of every single specialty. It's not just family physicians. It's not just surgeons. Radiologists, a little bit different. ICU, I mean, but these are questions that are legit, and I think oftentimes what we see is patients are afraid to ask their doctors to seem to be challenging their physicians, but I always say, ask these questions. If you don't feel that you can ask it yourself, bring a son or a daughter or a spouse or another person who can speak on your behalf and ask these questions.
I would say that it's good for a patient to have a healthy skepticism, not cynicism. There are many, many interventions that clearly have benefit. But when it gets to especially screening, it is often a very close call. And sometimes the physicians themselves aren't quite up to date on the latest literature and the summary of the literature. And that's why I think it's good to go to databases like the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force that does a systematic review of all the evidence. They don't have conflicts of interest. The PDQ, the same thing. We don't issue guidelines, but we summarize the evidence. And there are patient versions, certainly for the PDQ and for most of the task force statements as well. And it's good to read them. First, read the patient version, then I think you're well enough armed to read the health professional version and go to a physician. Of course, it's a social exchange with a physician, and if the physician gets upset or angry that you are showing them evidence from a reliable source, then maybe that's not the physician you're going to feel comfortable with, and there's nothing wrong with going to a physician who handles those discussions well and can see both sides of the issue. Too frequently, the reason I mentioned the two of the databases is sometimes guidelines, it's almost impossible to not have conflicts. Did they come in with intellectual biases and so forth? So with respect at least to prevention, the prevention and screening, the task force is a very reliable source. And I like to believe that with respect to cancer prevention and screening, the PDQ is also reliable.
It looks like we have more questions.
This isn't a question as much as an experience to share that this doesn't just happen with the elderly. Yeah. My 16-year-old, we took him to the emergency room and the advice of the pediatrician for an appendix. High blood, white blood count. The nurse with 30 years of experience said, yep, it's appendicitis, he'll have to be operated on tomorrow. The brand new baby doctor in the emergency room said, I need to see it. We put my poor son through about 4 imaging tests, including drinking dye, which he threw up twice and had to keep drinking, so that this young fellow could get an image, which we never got. And the surgeon the next day looked at the blood test and said, I would have operated based only on that. The only good thing that came of this is a year and a half later, when my nephew went through the same thing, my sister was now educated enough to put a foot down and say, call the surgeon. So my nephew didn't have to go through four different imaging tests. But that happens, and there's nothing as a parent in the emergency room I could do to prevent my son from being tortured, much less the co-payments. Just saying.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much. I was going to ask each of our doctors, and I know you may want to comment on this case too, if they had, since we have a little over 15 minutes left, if they had some advice for people to avoid overtreatment or overdiagnosis in either themselves or a loved one. Is there anything that this mother could have done to push back successfully, or was she at the mercy of these doctors?
I think parents are actually in a powerful position. We sometimes, it's not obvious, but I think knowing that you actually have the ability to say, you know, we tried once and he threw up, we tried a second time and he threw up again, and I think we're done with that. And I'm sure you tried, and so I can't comment on your experience particularly, but in medicine there's often more than one way to get an answer, more than one way to do something, and sometimes that asking for that creativity and collaboration can be a powerful way to move things in a slightly different direction. I'm sorry that happened to you.
Yeah, I'm sorry it happened to you. One other suggestion I would have, and I think you didn't talk about the pediatrician, but sometimes when we send patients or patients find themselves in the emergency room with no background about who they are, what their values are, what their previous health or what their lifestyles are, it's very different for a physician who sees them for the first time to make calls about their treatment. And so sometimes it would be a good idea to tell the person, if it's not a huge emergency, please call my primary care doctor, the pediatrician, the family doctor. Talk to them. They can tell you, they can give you a bigger picture of this person, whether this is something that they would even want. So again, in huge emergencies, you can't do that. But recognize that somebody who sees you for the first time in this kind of situation where you're in pain or having other symptoms may not be a full enough picture of what you or a loved one is going through or should have done to them.
There are two comments. The first, the technical element. Probably the CAT scan wasn't necessary. It could have been done with an ultrasound. That's certainly the way we're moving these.
The ultrasound person didn't see anything.
Oh. The second is cultural. About 15 to 20 years ago, people would perform an appendectomy merely on history, physical examination, the hamburger test. Are you hungry? And if the answer is no, if the answer is yes, it's very unlikely. If the answer is no, and on physical signs and white cell count. Now, many people, surgeons as well, are just very reluctant to take somebody for an appendectomy and have a negative appendix, meaning a non-inflamed appendix. So unfortunately, that's a trend that's going to be very difficult to reverse, because I don't think it's specific to any one doctor. This is one where there's a huge cultural push towards having confirmation before taking out appendix. And also because of the fact that lots of times now appendectomy isn't done open, but through the laparoscope, which means that you really want to know where it is and so on and so forth. But I think that the second time round there was a level of awareness, which is really what you sort of need. Do I really need that test? If you're so certain that I have the diagnosis, why waste time? Because that too can be harmful, trying to get the diagnosis by imaging when you're very certain that it's there in the first place.
Do any of you have other, I know I want to get to as many questions as possible, but do any of you have any other tips for avoiding overdiagnosis that we can give people today?
I mean, I think I mentioned this before, and we often think about using this kind of phrase of the best case and worst case scenario for patients with complex or very serious illness, but potentially it applies here as well. So if you, for example, could have asked the emergency room physician, what's the best case scenario with the CT scan, and what's, you know, or without the CT scan, what's the best case scenario, the worst case scenario, and potentially the worst case scenario without confirmation, because we have this imaging test, is that you have a surgery and they find out that it was not appendicitis. But the best case scenario is that you go to the surgery, you didn't need the CT scan, and your son could have avoided this contrast and sort of this, what sounds like a pretty terrible situation. But then you can also ask, what about the best and worst case scenario if we do have the CT scan? So the best case is, what if they find a different diagnosis that requires a very different procedure, or even you could avoid surgery altogether because of the CT scan? Well, that seems like maybe it's worth going through the test. But if the worst case scenario is that you end up throwing up miserable, you don't get the results anyways, and then you still have surgery, you know, potentially trying to understand from the physician how they can tell that story for you may help you start to advocate for yourself during the treatment decisions.
I really love that idea of instead of telling someone you've got a 16% chance of this or a 2% chance, and I think in your paper you mentioned, you know, if you tell someone best case scenario, you're in a nursing home for the rest of your life. If they think the best case scenario is unbearable, then that might really help them make a decision about whether or not to have that surgery. And in terms of tips, Dr. Mishori, when you and I were talking about over-medication and how people come in with bags and bags of medication, is there a way to manage that so people don't get put on medication they don't really need?
Yeah, I mean, first of all is to come clean, bring everything that you're taking and have the conversation. Insist on having the conversation if your doctor doesn't prompt you to do that. But, you know, asking three questions. Why am I on this medication? What is it for? What are the potential harms and what are the benefits? And going through every single one of these medications and trying to determine. And oftentimes the doctor will say, yeah, actually you don't need that. You've been on this for a year for something that happened, you know, 2 years ago. It is irrelevant at the moment. Not saying that the process of that we call deprescribing is an easy process. It's not easy. It requires a lot of thought and a lot of planning, and it could be a prolonged process. But certainly from the patient perspective, asking about everything that you take, why do I need to be on this? And this also translates to procedures, not just medications. Why do I need this procedure? What are the possible harms, as everyone was saying? What are the possible benefits to a good case-by-case scenario? But empowering yourselves, your family members, to ask these questions is critical.
I think one thing to add to that, too, from when we think about surgical procedures, too, is making sure that that physician is aware of your whole picture. So both the complete list of medical issues that you're dealing with, but also your life roles and responsibilities and priorities. Because if you're going to propose a surgery that then creates a side effect that it changes the way that you need to live, you might actually say, oh, maybe we should actually do this other procedure, or we should reevaluate whether this is the right thing to do. For example, if you live your life in a certain way that will make it difficult for you to live that way.
Yeah, I know people who've just decided to live with their particular disability rather than have surgery because they can't afford to take a month off from taking care of their kids. They right. can't be in bed for a month. Did we have other questions?
Thank you for the conversation so far. I have a personal story, and I also have sort of a health services question. I work for the state of Maryland, and we have global budgets, which are, we have sort of a set budget that our hospitals can spend during the year, so our hospitals are not on fee-for-service. But we are also looking at low-value care and sort of over-treatment and what's happening in the hospital setting. So even though we still have fee-for-service, and fee-for-service still very much affects our system, it's something that happens even without sort of a fee-for-service basis, and something that really is impacted by sort of patients and doctors. And as part of that, my question is, there's been a lot of talk, and I think it's really important, about what's important to the patient and what the goals are for the patient, and that's not something that you'll ever see in claims data or even sometimes in medical records data and EHR data. So I was wondering, are there types of measures or things that you think are always something that shouldn't be done, or for almost everyone shouldn't be done? And so those are things we could sort of point at and say, that's not a great thing to do. So that's my first piece. And then my second piece is just to talk about sort of the patient and the family and unnecessary care in those conversations. My mom has a ton of chronic health conditions, and she's constantly going to different specialists. Some of them are talking to each other, some of them aren't. And so she had one doctor tell her to get a bunion surgery. And my mom has, she has rheumatoid arthritis, she has knee issues, she has a lot of different things. She lives alone in New Jersey, so there was no way she could have bunion surgery. It just wasn't going to work. And so she was getting ready to get all set up, and I said, no. And so now, anytime a doctor sort of even prescribes something, I ask her to say, okay, that sounds good, let me hold off, and I have her call me, so at least I can be somewhere else and Googling, because it's harder to do it when you're in front of the doctor. So I Google in the back end and then give her information to share. So that's just my experience.
You're a good daughter.
Sorry.
I wanted to piggyback off what she said. My name is Kathy Madsen, and I support a health services research project at the Uniformed Services University, where we are using big data to look systemically at systemic overuse, low-value care in the military health system. Mm. And I've heard a lot of discussion today about patient and provider interactions as a driver of keeping those low. I've heard a couple mentions of big data. How would you go about moving from the, for instance, Johns Hopkins did the 19 indicator procedures that if you see these, you're probably seeing greater overuse. How would you move from that to the bedside?
Let me give you an example for, I'm thinking specifically about cancer screening in people towards the end of life. So there are very specific guidelines about what age is the recommended time to stop cancer screening. For women, for men, breast cancer, colonoscopy. Oftentimes, we kind of, physicians do order these as a matter of like, you know, sort of a knee-jerk reaction. We just continue because we don't think about it. So again, it would be very useful to have more systemic reminders, for example, on the electronic, I mean, people would kill me for saying that because nobody wants any more reminders on the electronic health records. But that would be something that would be useful to prevent low-value care. Even a reminder to have the conversation. I'm not suggesting that, oh, the person is 75 years old, you cannot even order the mammogram, because some 75-year-olds should have a mammogram. But at least a reminder to have that conversation based on guidelines. And of course, as it was already mentioned, we need to really look specifically at each person and their priorities and quality of life issues.
I think another thing we've talked about in the implementation world is thinking about what are the specific actions that you can take. And one of the effective ways that's been shown is you actually show physicians their own practices in comparison to the community. So you do individualized sort of audit and feedback. But then I think to go another step, we also know that physicians use scripts, like we tend to develop ways that we describe things, and it's very hard to try out something new when you don't actually have a way that you usually say it. So if we paired the big data and what you do with an invitation to, here's a way to describe de-implementation of breast cancer screening, like that might be an actual way that you can make that next step. Which sounds exciting, by the way.
We gave a presentation on this topic, and it was not gracefully received by the clinicians in the room. Like, even the term was considered inflammatory and divisive. So there was definitely the strong bias between the researcher side and the clinician side. And I greatly appreciate everyone's willingness to bridge that gap today.
And I think that the term that you introduced, de-implementation, is critical to think about it. We also use de-prescribing. And the issue is, I think it's always harder to take something off that you've already started, and whether it's life support or whether it's medications or you already started a procedure. So the idea of studying it, we don't have a lot of evidence about even how to do it, how to counsel our medical students and residents, how to de-implement or de-prescribe. It just doesn't exist yet, but we need to continue thinking about it from that perspective.
And I think that reaction comes from a defensiveness. You never want to believe as a physician that you did something that harmed somebody. I think that's one of the things that keeps a lot of us up at night is this idea, did I hurt somebody when my job is actually to help? And I think that defensiveness is a natural reaction. I've had it aimed at me too, and it's hard.
And I think that defensiveness from the clinicians also comes from, again, to sort of reiterate this point that a lot of this is driven by system level sort of latent features of the environment that we're operating in, and clinicians are really at the bedside trying to do the best, in my opinion, it's sort of in almost every single case. And so it's hard to justify that and sort of reconcile that in your head, that you know you're in a system that may be providing overtreatment.
Yeah, and I think for the EHR reminders, it's always like, this is what you should do. There are very few opportunities to say this is what you shouldn't do, and one that we're beginning to see is about overprescribing of antibiotics. So
I had to talk a doctor out of that.
Right. So this is now one of the first examples of actually having reminders when you're about to click the amoxicillin, do you really need this antibiotic? So this is, we're beginning to kind of help physicians not do things as opposed to do them, reminding them to do them.
Just to continue on this idea of managing uncertainty, it seemed to be a theme today. So if medicine, the House of Medicine, successfully does begin to curb overtreatment, it seems there may be a corresponding rise in uncertainty, you know, hearing from patients on the provider side especially, but really kind of thinking specifically on the patient side, say my father is diagnosed with a turtle, for example. What are your suggestions for strategies or tools that patients might manage uncertainty, or even ways that doctors might help us and families do so?
So with one example that I have on the question that you've posed is small renal masses, kidney masses that could be cancer, most likely are, but are innocuous cancers. So what are we trying to do here? We're trying to prevent their overtreatment. Their overtreatment, to all credit to the urologist, they now just do very small excisions. They don't have to take the whole kidney out. But nevertheless, it's still a procedure. It will come at some price. And the price that it comes at is surveillance, increased surveillance. So you can't just say, right, you've got this small mass. It's probably an overdiagnosis. You'll probably get overtreated, go home. You then have to say, okay, you have a small mass. We have two options. We can either take it out or we can put you on surveillance. We can start the surveillance at 3 months, then go to 6 months. And actually, I've seen a lot of that. I've seen people with these small cancers that were diagnosed, that were first seen 12 years ago, and they're still there. They haven't increased in size. But the point I'm making is that if you want to reduce overtreatment, then there may need to be another price to pay, which is investigations or surveillance. Surveillance is probably a better word because you're not really investigating anymore. You're just making sure that it isn't changing in size. But it can be done.
Some of the solution may be at the training level of health professionals. There's a book about the history of medical education for the 20th century, and the number one problem identified by the medical historian Kenneth Ludmer was that there was a deficiency of training for uncertainty in medical school. And his thesis was that led to a systematic overuse of testing and overtreatment. And so if neither the physician or the patient are trained to think and accept uncertainty, then they're almost always, at least in our medical culture, going to lean in one direction. So education and probabilistic thinking is one. The other is knowing when you don't have to make a decision right then and there. Obviously, having a radical prostatectomy is irrevocable, or having a mastectomy is irrevocable at that point. There are situations that we're learning about where it's uncertain what the best way to go is, but there's pretty good evidence that waiting and seeing what the natural history of the disease is acceptable. And sometimes that's very difficult. The third is to try to keep the decision and the discussion focused on what is known about the particular disease. So in the case of cancer, whenever you introduce the word cancer, there's a famous saying that if thought corrupts language, the opposite is certainly the case. So as soon as you have an entity with the word cancer or carcinoma in it, it sometimes shuts off the ability to really understand and get informed about what the disease really is, what the likelihood is. So there's some movement, not uniformly accepted, to change the name of some of these things that we call cancer if we know, if we have enough biological information to know they don't act like the routine cancer. And that at least moves the word off the table, and you can focus on what's known, what's not known, and try to handle the uncertainties.
One thing that wasn't introduced is the combination, which is really terrible, of uncertainty and a litigious society. There are days when I go home and I ask myself again and again and again, should I have actually ordered that test? I think I probably shouldn't have, but is that patient gonna sue me? God forbid they are going to be the one patient of the, you know, this 1,000 who will be the one coming down with that rare form or aggressive form of prostate cancer, for example. And that happened to my friend. He followed all the guidelines about PSA testing, and this one person was the person who he didn't test, who ended up having prostate cancer, and sued the heck out of him. Do you think my friend continued with not offering PSA testing to all of his other patients for a while? It was a very difficult decision for him. But I think the combination of this uncertainty, both from the physician perspective and what the patient's expectations are, is very difficult if you think you might be sued.
Well, this has been great. We're right at time, but maybe we can take one more question.
Hi, my name is Rhiannon Lewis, and so during our discussion earlier, someone mentioned something about how like the system contributes to the cost or the effects of overtreatment or the prevalence of overtreatment, and how that could be a latent effect, such as I think someone mentioned something about the availability of resources or having a surgeon on call. And I was wondering if there are any policy solutions that could be implemented to help curb the costs of overtreatment or just overtreatment in general.
I think that every time you mention overtreatment and you focus on the savings, you get the people who say, oh, this is rational, you know, this is socialism and socialized medicine. So I try to not talk about it in terms of these types of policy and economic perspectives. But I don't know.
I think closed healthcare systems where they have a certain pot of money and then a group of people get to decide how it's spent in their community is one approach. Another approach that I've seen being used lately is this idea of citizen juries. And I apologize, I saw it first in a BMJ article. I can't remember who the first author was, but this idea that actually you get people from the community to decide what are we going to spend our money on, so that there's a group consensus about what we think represents high and low value care in our society. And that's a policy way that isn't quite so top down, but has some input from people who are experiencing it on a day-to-day basis.
I think there is much that can be done. We, as a specialist society, physicians and organizations, we get to define what disease is. And when we get to define what disease is, we end up actually defining what normal is as well. So I think, quite bluntly, we have to raise the threshold for what constitutes disease, what constitutes the point at which you intervene, what constitutes the point at which you call something abnormal. And I think there's a secular trend towards that becoming lower and lower and lower. I think that we have to reverse that.
Pre-diabetes is a good example. I would maybe make a different point about way we can start to change the system and think about these latent influences. And so I think there's very few things, very few absolute things that we can say this is overtreatment no matter what. And I think what we keep coming back to is the idea that overtreatment is a very personalized problem, and it depends on what an individual patient's goals are. So a system level approach to that type of problem would be creating the system to make sure we elicit patients' individual goals at regular intervals as they change with disease processes, with all new diagnoses, and sort of when they're coming to their primary care physician potentially, and have a reliable place in the electronic health record that can capture what that means what kind of goals those are, so all of the physicians across that patient spectrum can have that same sort of window into what might be individualized and personalized care for the patient.
And I love your idea of the chair as the one of the central tools in
more chairs.
More chairs in the ICU. When you go to the hospital, the nurses often have a whiteboard that they'll put really salient points like latex allergy or, you know, don't let the patient fall. I don't know. And maybe we should have the patient's goal of care written on a whiteboard somewhere. Like
it does get incorporated into some charts these days.
Yeah, you know, wants to be with family. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Davies, Dr. Jha, Dr. Mishori, Dr. Kramer, and Dr. Kramer. And I don't care what Dr. Kramer says. These are still five of the smartest people in the country. You've taught us a lot. And the bad news is we're out of time, but the good news is you can go to Twitter and use our hashtag, KHN News Live. You can continue the conversation there or on Facebook and keep the conversation going. Thanks.